Thinking is easy, but working hard on a regular basis is challenging. But remember that nothing is impossible and you can do this. And this video, I'm going to help you out to crack your NEET PG to make your dream come true. Hello friends, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Paathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And this video is a little effort to help you prepare for your NEET PG exam. Subscribe and join me in your beautiful challenging journey to crack NEET PG. So without further ado, let's get started. So welcome back to another NEET series, and today's video we are going to talk about the radiation biology. Even though this is not that important topic for NEET point of view, but there may ask any question from the radiation biology. So for that reason and also for our knowledge, we should know that what are the effect of radiation on the oral tissues. And before we get started, remember that everything we got in the world for free, our body, our soul, our mind, our brain, our ambitions, our dreams, our intelligence, everything, all these priceless possessions we got us for free. These are the important things which we cannot get it at the cost of money. And so does our channel Dental Paathshala, where I guide you through your dream. And this video, this lecture, we are talking about the radiation exposure. Now, when there is a last video, we have talked about the physics, right? Now, what happens when there is a radiation which is coming a high speed? It is going to expel this electron out of its shell, and there is going to be the ionized electron. So this atom, it get ionized, and there can be two effects. Either it is going to directly come on the DNA, and there can be two things. Either it is breaking the single strand or breaking the double strand. Or the second thing can be, it is going to ionize the water. And then this ionized water is going to damage the DNA. It is going to work on that. So we have got, based on that, either it is a direct or it is an indirect. Both of these ionization, we see that there are biochemical lesions which are formed. These biochemical lesions, they have two kind of effect. One is the deterministic effect and other one is the stochastic effect. So deterministic effect is, as the name suggests, it is going to determine on the dose of the radiation. That means below a threshold level, there is no tissue damage. That means suppose I am taking x-ray of any patient and I am getting exposed to the exposure. So in that case, there is no damage to my tissues. So that is when there is a sub-threshold level, there is no damage. But when there is a threshold above the threshold level, so it depends on the dose. Severity of the symptom will depend on the dose. How much, how more the dose is, how severe the symptom it will give. But the stochastic effect is exactly opposite of it. It says that the threshold, without even a threshold, so disease can occur by chance. For example, it is telling that in case of sublethal radiation also can cause any damage to the DNA. So it is saying, for example, radiation induced cancer, that is exposing the chance of the cancer. When there is radiation, there may be cancer. But we have not given any specific data that this particular, any specific dose, that this particular dose, above this dose, there will be cancer. So like that, this is a stochastic effect. And also we see that there are some effect on the enzymes. So the effect on the enzymes are going to be, there are some factors. So before that, let's see some factors. There are some factors. First one is the dose. So more the doses, more severe are the symptoms. This is above the threshold dose. Then we have a dose rate. Dose rate means the rate at which you are giving dose. Suppose if I'm giving 20 CVT, of the radiation. And one thing is, if I am giving at once 20 sievert, another thing is, if I am giving this 20 sievert dose in 2 days and two times. So that way, one day 10 and one time will be 5. Then again, one time will be 5 sievert, and that will be given in fractions. So depend on, see, there is a low dose rate, that is when we are giving in the fractions. So it has low effect, it is going to do less damage compared to the one which is given in one single shot, one single large dose, that is going to do the more damaging effect. Again, the next one we have is the oxygen. Oxygen is when there is oxygen present in the tissue. So what happens? There is going to be the breakage into hydrogen peroxide as well as some free radical ion. So there are some free radicals which are formed. So these free radicals and hydrogen peroxide, they are going to do lot of tissue damage. And that is the reason that we are creating hypoxic condition. Right. So there is one more thing. So we are not creating hypoxic. I'm sorry. We are giving hyperbaric oxygen therapy before the radiation therapy. Before we give the radiation any patient, we give the hyperbaric oxygen therapy. So this, what happens when we are giving this hyperbaric oxygen therapy before doing the radiation therapy, then all the cells will be filled with 100% oxygen. Basically what happens, this hyperbaric oxygen therapy is we are giving at some hyperbaric, as the name suggests, there is going to be atmospheric pressure. So the atmospheric pressure which we create, there is a chamber in which we ask the patient to sit. So there are some seats. In this seat, this is like the atmospheric pressure is equal to 33 meters below the sea level. So this much of pressure is created inside this chamber. And also what we see that there is 100% oxygen which is provided to the oxygen. So all the cells are with 100% oxygen. Now what happens when these cells are filled with oxygen and we are giving the radiation, that means there is going to be more damage because we want damage to the tumor cells. So the tumor cells will kill, and the radiation effect in low dose also, this will cause more effect. So fourth one we have is the LET. LET is the linear energy transfer. Linear energy transfer is a dose which is going to cause effect on the biological tissues. So in case if any of the particles, suppose alpha particles, we talked about alpha particles, they are very lethal. They are going to do more damage. That means they have got high LET. So all these things, all these radiations, particles with the higher LET, they are more efficient in damaging the biological tissues compared to the, because they have got higher ionization density. Now that's why it is more likely to cause the double stranded DNA damage. And we know that double stranded DNA damage is more lethal compared to the single stranded DNA damage, right? So in case of an other, when there is a low LET, LET is again linear energy transfer, then there is going to be a single stranded DNA damage. So what happens to the proteins? What happens to the proteins? There is going to be breakage in the hydrogen bond, disulfide bond. So breakage in the hydrogen bond, breakage in the sulfide bond. And because of that, there is going to be the change in the secondary or the tertiary structure of the proteins. And also we see that these enzymes, they were making the substrate. But what happens because of the radiation, the effect is such a way that it deactivates the enzyme. So the enzyme which was powerful earlier, now the enzyme is inactivated. So because of that, the substrate is not formed, and that is the reason it causes so many effect on the tissues. Also, we see that there is inactivation of the enzyme, and we see that there is going to be denaturation of the protein, right? So an effect on DNA is that, and the DNA also, it is going to break the strand. So there is between hydrogen bonds are there. So the between this hydrogen bond also it is going to break, or it may break one of the strand, or if so much of high dose, see, to break single strand we require very high dose. But if high dose is there, then there is going to be double strand DNA damage. So DNA double strand damage, we know that is lethal. Or there can be any translocation or transcription like that. It can also be there. So it can be any change also in the base. Any change in the base. That can also happen. So nucleus is more radioactive. More radio sensitive. The nucleus is more radiosensitive. Now, what do you mean by radiosensitive? Radiosensitive means if anything is sensitive to the radiation. Suppose if I am sensitive to any soap, so that means my skin is going to react on that soap. So, same goes with the radiation therapy. If any cell is sensitive to the radiation therapy, that means when the radiation comes, there is going to be some change in the cell. So, there is going to be some change in the cell that will happen because of radiation. That is the radiosensitive. So in the cell, we see that nucleus is the most radiosensitive, and that also we see that DNA. So what happens basically, DNA, chromatin material is more radiosensitive compared to the cytoplasm. If you want to see changes in the cytoplasm, then you need to give a way larger dose. If you want to see changes in the cytoplasm and the tissues. So, the sensitive site are the DNA and the chromosomes. In the DNA and cell cycle, see, cell cycle, what do we see? That is also an important question. That which particular part of the cell cycle, we know that first one is the G1, right? So, the G1 phase, then we have got the S phase, wherein the DNA is formed. Now, when the DNA is formed, then we will see the changes. Before the DNA is formed, then there will not be any changes which is seen. That is the reason that S phase is the least sensitive. Least sensitive. But if we talk about G2 phase. G2 phase, once the DNA is formed, now the radiation is going to act on the DNA. We know that DNA is the most sensitive. That is the reason that G2 phase is most sensitive phase. Or one arm of the chromosome is broken. But before the DNA replication, if we talk about the S phase or the G1 phase, so there is break in the both the arms at next mitosis. So there can be chromosome aberrations which can be seen. But the highest frequency of the chromosome aberration, highest frequency of the radio sensitivity is seen at the G2 phase. Remember the G2 phase. Chromosome aberrations also we see that there is going to be there is going to be ring formation which we see. Suppose this was a chromosome like that earlier. Now after the radiation therapy, there is a ring which is formed in the chromosome. Also we see that there is going to be translocation. So suppose earlier it was like this. So there is going to be, we see that there is translocation. So all these things are the changes in the chromosome also we see. Also we see that there is going to be increase in the sodium potassium pump. And because of that, active transport also starts in the body. So basically, what happens? What are the changes according to the dose, of course, and according to the time also. So if you see less than 1 second, so less than 1 second, if it is 10 raised to power equal to or less than 10 raised to power minus 15 second, then there are some physical, then there is going to be only the formation of the water ion. If the exposure is 10 raised to power minus 15 to 10 raised to power minus 12 seconds, we are talking about here, is there is going to be the initial, some initial ions are formed, initial species are formed, that is the water ion, OH ion, and then we have got E aqua. So there are, now we are going, this is less than 1 second we are talking till now. So if there is 10 raised to power minus 12 to 10 raised to power minus 6, then again these particles, these ions, they either react with one another or they become widely separated into that specific area where radiation is given. Now talking about when there is effect on 1 second, when the radiation exposure is up to 1 second, then there are biological, biochemical changes which are seen. In minutes, we see that there is going to be change in the cell division. In days, we see that there we will cover that. We are going to cover when we are going to do in on the effect on the body. Then you will all again see this. So in the days, there is going to be GI and the CNS, acute radiation syndrome. In the end, we are going to cover in this video. then weeks there is going to be the fibre, because it's in air, that means. So there is going to be lung fibrosis. All the alveoli in the lungs, they get fibrosed. And if it is in ears, then we know that. Hiroshima, Nagasaki, you all know that. When it is in ears, then it is going to affect on the upcoming generation, affect the offspring. There is going to be genetic effect, or there can be cancer or cataract, which is seen. Coming to the oral tissues. So what are the effect on the oral tissues? Right? So we know that most common carcinoma we have already covered is the SCC. What kind of SCC are we going to give the radiation therapy? Now, it is very important then that we know that what are the cells which we call it the radiosensitive cells. What are the cells which we call it the radioresistant cells. Right? Now, you have got these many type of cells. Now, they may look scary to you, but they are not. So, to remember this, first of all, remember that the most radiosensitive cells. The most radiosensitive cells are the cells basically which undergo mitosis, which have got high mitotic rate, which can multiply at much faster rate, which multiply, which divide. So these are the most radio sensitive cells. First thing. Second thing, first of all, they should have the high mitotic rate. And second thing is that whatever shape, size, feature they are in, they multiply to the same shape and size. That means they are not undergoing differentiation. So these cells which are not undergoing differentiation, which have increased mitotic activity, are the most radiosensitive cells. Now, from your common sense, you have to see all these cells, which are these kind of cells. These are the basal cells, right? These are our precursor cells, all the precursor cells, like arthroblastic cells, like spermatogenic cells. So, all these cells are the cells which are most radiosensitive. Now, these kind of cells are the vegetative intermitotic cells. The least one, that means the resistance. So, the resistance, radioresistant cell are what kind of cells? Exactly opposite to it. So, the radioresistant cells are the cells which are undergoing differentiation. So, which are undergoing differentiation. So, these are the least resistant cell, and they are not dividing also once they mature. So, these kind of cells, which are, they are very stubborn. They are not going to, once they are matured, they are not going to divide. So, these kind of cell will come into fixed post-mitotic. As the name suggests, post-mitotic, they become fixed. They are so stubborn, they become fixed post-mitotic. So, example for these kind of cells, which once they are matured, they are incapable of divisions, are our nerve cells, are our neurons, are the muscle cells, striated muscle cells, epithelial cells, and the RBC. How can we forget RBC? So, in between what we have, look for the name, differentiating intermitotic. That means they are dividing, but they are differentiating also. So, that is the reason they come at second number. So, the most radiosensitive to the least radiosensitive, this is the order. So, second one are the differentiating intermitotic, which are radiosensitive, but less than vegetative. So, they are going to divide regularly and they undergo differentiation. The example for this is the hematopoietic series, cells of hematopoietic series, spermatocytes, oocytes, and most importantly, inner enamel epithelium of the tooth bud. So, inner enamel epithelium of the developing teeth. Next one is the multipotent connective tissue cells. So, these are the connective tissue cells like fibroblast, mesenchymal cells. So, whenever there is a response, they are going to divide. But they are not dividing regularly. They are just dividing in response. So, that are the multipotent connective tissue cells. So, the fourth one we have the reverting post-mitotic cells. So, reverting post-mitotic cells are the radio. Now, the radio resistance come from here. So R from reverting, you can remember R from radio resistant cells. They are long lived. They die without dividing, but they divide only in specific conditions, like all these gland cells. So the parenchymal cells of the gland, adductor cells, S inner cells, all the special cells will come under these reverting post mitotic cells. So if the question asks that the most radio sensitive cells are, you have to think that who are not undergoing differentiation and who have got the high mitotic activity. So all the precursor cells and basal layer is going to be the layer of the radio sensitive. And the second number comes to the lymphocytes, oocytes, and inner enamel epithelium cells. All these come under. And if we talk about the least radio sensitive, that means we are talking about the radio resistant. That means the last one, muscles, striated muscle cells, nerve cells, epithelial cells, RBCs, all this come under the fixed post mitotic cells. So now you see the susceptibility of different organ to the radiation therapy. So who are going to respond well based on the differentiation and the mitotic activity again. So the highest mitotic activity precursor cells of the blood, right? So that occur in the bone marrow. So bone marrow, then lungs, we have colon, stomach, and we have got the breast. So low, we have the bone cells, brain cells, we have already studied the nerve cells, all the nerve cells, and the salivary gland also, they have got least effect. This is the reason that most of the time when we are removing the SCC, and in case of it is present in the salivary gland, or in case we do the surgical resectioning, we don't do the radiotherapy, and in skin. So intermediate, we have the bladder, liver, and the thyroid. So now we are going to study the radiation effects on the oral tissues. What are the effects of the radiation therapy on the oral tissue? So the all the lesions, all the cancer, which is the malignant or radiosensitive area is there, radiosensitive cell are involved, advanced lesion is there, deeply invasive is there, which we cannot approach surgically, we do the radiation therapy. Like the nasopharynx cancer, tonsillar cancer, SCC of tonsil, or if SCC is present at the floor of the mouth, or if soft palate is involved. But the area which we can do surgically, we don't go for the radiation therapy, or which are the least radiosensitive, like we talked about just now, salivary gland. So there is the source of radiation which we take is the cobalt, and the implant material which we take is the radon. So radon is the same material which is present in the earth, or the iodine. Iodine also we can take for implant material. Like implant material, what we do take the radioactive substance, we put it in the tumor cells. So what are the effect, let's see, on the oral mucous membrane. So first of all, we know that the basement membrane or the basal layer of the mucous membrane is the most radio sensitive. So that means sensitive. So that means every time I write the spelling wrong, because I get so involved in teaching that I keep on forgetting the spellings. So the sensitive, radiosensitive, vegetative, or differentiating intermitotic cells. So these are the basically basal cells. Basal cells of oral mucous membrane comes under the vegetative intermitotic cells, which we have just now covered. So by the end of the second week, we see that the patient will, at the beginning of the end of the second week, we see that there is going to be some redness which is coming, and we see that there is inflammation which we see in case of. So end of the therapy, so this we call it the mucositis. So end of the therapy, what we see, that this mucositis has gone severe. So there are three things which we are going to study. When is the effect on these particular things, when the effect is going to be severe, and when the effect will resolve. So there is going to be severe mucositis at the end of the radiation therapy, but we will ask the patient to maintain a good oral hygiene. And patient is so painful after the end of the radiation therapy, so many reasons, because saliva is not there, oral mucous membrane, because of that, you know, end of the I forgot to tell you, end of the second week, what happens after the second week, there is going to be white or yellow pseudomembrane which is formed. And one more thing is there. Also, candidiasis is also there, secondary infection. So, and the patient will start recovering from this mucositis 2 months after the radiation therapy gets over. But there are the long-term effect of the radiation therapy on the mucous membrane is that the mucous membrane will become very thin. And there will be less vascular supply because the radiation therapy, it affects the microvasculature, the epithelium of the microvasculature. So that is the reason that everything becomes avascular. Everywhere the vascular supply start reducing. What happens when the cell is not getting enough of oxygen? It will not get enough of enzyme. It will not get, it will not get anything because of blood is not coming. So anything won't come. So the cell will start going into atrophy. This is the reason that we see there is a mucositis. There we see that there is a atrophy of the mucous membrane also due to progressive obliteration of the fine vasculature, and there is a fibrosis of the connective tissue that also we see, and ulcers will be present on the mucous membrane coming to taste bud. So taste bud are sensitive to radiation. Again, you will see that there is a loss in the taste. The patient complain of loss in the taste sensation usually after 2 to 3 weeks of the therapy started. So we see that, suppose this is the tongue, anterior 1/3 of the tongue is if radiated, then the patient will lose the sensation of the salt and the sweet. SS. Okay. If posterior 2/3 of the tongue is radiated, then there is going to be loss in the or change in the bitter or the acid flavors. But again, patient will recover in 60 to 120 days. And also we see, you know why these sensations are going losing, patient sensation? Because the patient will lose up to 1K to 10K. 10K subscriber, which I am thinking of that before my birthday, we will have 10,000. That is what I am estimating. So this is how I learn values. So 1 to 10K taste bud will be lost after or during the radiation therapy. So there is also, we see that decrease in the saliva, and but the taste sensation patient will reoccur, will recover after 60 to 120 days. Coming to salivary gland. So what do we see in the saliva? Actually, you know what happens at times, the exposure to the salivary gland is unavoidable. This is unnecessarily sometimes exposed. So the most common one we have is the parotid one. So there is a parotid gland which is most commonly radiosensitive. Then comes our sublingual and submandibular. So the parenchymal component is the most radiosensitive in the salivary gland. Otherwise, salivary gland is not affected much. We have already covered that it is the least affected. But mostly what is there is that the parenchymal component, the serous acini cells, they are not that involved. They are involved with a high radiation exposure. Initially, we see that there is acute inflammation. So in the histopathological view of these acini cells, we see that there is going to be acute inflammatory reaction. Which and also, you know, important one is increase in the serum amylase. So this enzyme, we see that it is increased, and we, you know what, after the 3 hours of radiation therapy, this enzyme, we will see in the lab results that there is increase in the serum amylase. So it occurs 3 hours. This enzyme increases 3 hours after the therapy, and the peak increase of serum amylase we will see in 12 to 24 hours. So remember, in the first day, and then the normal value of the serum amylase will come after the 96 hours. So with time progresses, this acute inflammation is changed to the chronic inflammation. We see that the acinar cells are progressively undergoing fibrosis, and there is a loss of the fine vasculature, there is a loss in the capillaries, and the parenchymal degeneration distortion is there we see. So the first few weeks, there is going to be decrease in the saliva. We know that well. We know that when the radiation effect on the mucosa, on the oral cavity is xerostomia. This is a huge one. There are two huge effects. One is the xerostomia, another one is the osteoradionecrosis. That is, we will discuss it after the extraction. So, xerostomia. Xerostomia is dryness of the mouth. This is the reason that because there is a fibrosis of the acinar cells, because there is a loss of the salivary secretion, we see that there is xerostomia. And because of the xerostomia, patient will have difficulty in the swallowing. So, patient won't be able to eat anything properly. And we also see there is an increase in the sodium, calcium and magnesium, protein. All these things are increases, but the saliva will lose its lubricating property. And hence also, we see that there are increase in the caries. This is the one reason for increase in the caries. The another increase in the caries reason is that the pH of the saliva also comes down. So, the pH, suppose normally it was 6.5. Now the pH is normal minus 1. That is, it will be 5.5. So, minus 1 pH. Yani towards the acidicity, the pH comes. And we know that when the pH is acidic, then there is more bacterial growth, then there is more plaque, then there is more caries. So, there is going to be increase in the S mutans, which causes the caries, lactobacillus, which progresses the caries, and candida. Candidiasis, which is the fungal infection. So whenever immunity is low, whenever anything is there, this fungal infection, it comes. So also we see that there is decrease in the buffering capacity up to 44%. So basically you have to understand this when the patient undergo radiation therapy. The xerostomia is the main reason in the oral cavity. Now teeth, there is not that effect on the teeth because adult teeth are radio resistant teeth. But if there is a radiation exposure in the children, that means the developing tooth bud will get destroyed. So, because of that developing tooth bud, there are the primary tooth which are coming. There are the secondary tooth bud which are coming. I mean the permanent tooth bud. And even to a child when there is a radiation exposure, a low radiation dose also will cause the hypoplastic enamel formation. So, caries in case of a patient having radiation exposure, we see that the caries, radiation caries are same as the rampant caries. We know that the rampant caries, once they involve almost all of the teeth. And the reason is there is decrease in the saliva, there is decrease in the pH, there is increase in the viscosity, and due to this reason, there is a caries. Now, there are three type of caries, radiation caries, which is seen. One is when it is involving the cementum and dentine. So what happens? It starts from cervically, both the sides, and it is starts from suppose one side, and it is will go circumferentially. So it will eat all of these crown. So there is going to be loss of crown. The second one we have is the generalized superficial lesions. There will be superficial lesions which are present on the buccal, lingual, proximal surfaces, palatal, incisal, occlusal, all these surfaces. Third one we have is the dark pigmentation we see. So there are pigmentation which are formed onto the entire of the crown, and we see that the incisal edges are worn off in this case. So how are we going to treat this rampant caries or this radiation caries? We are going to give 1% neutral sodium fluoride topical application daily to the patient. Daily when we are doing the radiation therapy, when somebody is undergoing the radiation therapy, in order to prevent the caries, the rampant caries, the highly progressing caries, we have to give the topical application of 1% neutral sodium fluoride daily. The bone, effect on the bone. So effect on the bone is there is going to be hypoxic bone, hypocellular bone, because there is no blood supply which is left. So no cells, endosteum will get atrophied. There is going to be lack of the osteoclastic cells. So all these things, what will happen? The bone will undergo necrosis. That means the bone will start dying. You know what happens? When after a radiation therapy, you extract the patient's teeth. Then the infection will from the mucous membrane, it will break, it will go into the bone, and in the bone it is going to leave a known healing wound. and thereby it will cause the osteoradionecrosis. Osteo means bone, radio means due to radiation therapy, necrosis is necrosis when there is a death of anything. So there is a osteoradionecrosis. Now this can be minimized, this can be improved if any poor prognosis teeth we extract before the radiation therapy, and we have to give LA with the low epinephrine or the lidocaine we should not use in that case. So osteoradionecrosis first of all is usually seen in the mandible. Reason being, in the mandible, you all know that mandible is a compact bone, it is very dense bone. It is very dense bone. So in the dense bone and vascular supply is already less. On the top of that, the fine vasculature is already dying because of the radiation therapy. So the bone become hypovascular, hypocellular, hypomineralized because of the decrease in the blood supply. So we either give the hyperbaric oxygen therapy, then, or we give the oxygen, or we can give the mucocutaneous, the flap. So also we can give the graft such as fifth rib. So talking about the last one is the muscle. So muscle is when there is a inflammation, what happens when there is a radiation to the muscle, there is going to be inflammation, fibrosis. Now all this result in the contracture of the muscle. Now the muscle of mastication, suppose this is the masseter. Now what happens, this when there is a contraction of the masseter, what will happen? So the patient won't be able to open the jaw. So there is going to be trismus because of the contraction of the masseter and the pterygoid muscles. So because of that contracture, there will be trismus. And you know what? It starts 2 months after the therapy gets over. So after 2 months after the post therapy, so we have to tell the patient to use the exercise program, which will help in the opening of the mouth for the patient. So coming to radiation to the whole body, now when the whole body is radiated after the radiation exposure, there is a syndrome which we see is the acute radiation syndrome. When the whole body is exposed to the radiation, then it is the acute radiation syndrome. And I know you'll be like, ma'am, this is very nice presentation, every time you teach like this, but it takes effort, bache. Okay, coming to acute radiation syndrome, also known as the radiation poisoning, radiation sickness, or the radiation toxicity. These are the collection of the symptoms to the whole body exposure to the radiation. Now, there can be a question which can be asked. Suppose they can ask that if 5 gray of radiation exposure is there, then what will be the effect? Effect is going to be on the bone marrow syndrome. So basically acute radiation syndrome, it consists of 3 syndromes. One is the bone marrow, second is the GI syndrome, third one is the CNS or the CVS syndrome. So it depends on the dose of the radiation exposure. So if there is only 1 to 2 gray of the exposure, then there are only prodromal syndromes. That is going to be nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, weakness, fatigue. Then if it is between 2 to 4, then it is a mild hematopoietic. If between 4 to 7, then severe hematopoietic. So the thing you have to remember is between 2 to 7 is going to be the bone marrow. So bone marrow, 2 words are there, bone marrow, again GI also 2 words are there, but still bone marrow. So 2 to 7, remember that, bone marrow. In the bone marrow, there is going to be, see, the cells, RBC, WBC, platelet, these all are radio resistant cell. They will not get affected after a radiation therapy because they are matured and they are not multiplying. We know that radio resistant cells are the cells wherein there is no division. Once they are differentiated, they are not going to divide, like there are RBCs, so they are not going to divide. But we have the hematopoietic stem cells. So the stem cells, which are the radiosensitive cells, so these cells are going to multiply also, and later on they can differentiate also. So these cells, which have got the high capacity of proliferation, multiplication, or the mitosis, are the cells which are radiosensitive cells, are the cells which will be affected most. So in the hematopoietic blood, we have got the precursor of the blood cells. So all these myeloid cells, they are going to form RBC, WBC, and platelets, right? So both, all three things will be affected. Only the formation we are talking about. Once the matured RBC are present and the person is radiated to X-ray, there will not be any effect. Once these RBC, which are already present in the blood, they are died. So once these are died, and then the new formed RBC will not be there in the blood. So the patient will go into anemia. So after a few weeks, we see all these symptoms. Few days, we will see leukopenia. So based on the formation of these cells. So based on the formation, the order will go like that. Because once the matured cell die, there is no other cell which is going to substitute the cell. So based on that, the order is there will be decrease in the granulocytes. Because granulocyte, they have a short span, then the platelet, then the RBC, like 5 days, 1 week, and then 120 days. So like that, the symptom will come lymphopenia, granulocytopenia, and then anemia. So what happens when there is decrease in the WBC count? We know that the patient will have secondary infection. We know that once, because WBC are the fighter cells, once the fighter cell are not there, then there will be increase in the chances of infection. So 7 to 15 is the GI syndrome. GI syndrome is the gastrointestinal syndrome. Gastrointestinal syndrome, there will be damage to the basal cells of the intestine. So intestinal basal cells will get damaged due to the radiation exposure. We know that most radiosensitive cells are the basal cells because these are the cells which are going to form the whole of the epithelium. These have got highly mitotic activity, highly proliferative cells. So GI syndrome, we see that there is going to be damage to the basal epithelial cells of the intestinal villus. Because of that, once there the mucosal barrier is lost, then the infection will spread, then the bacteria will invade, and also we see there is no nutrition absorption. Nutrition is not absorbed. There is electrolyte balance, sodium, potassium, and we see that again there is a secondary infection which comes. Also, there is ulceration in the GI tract, and because of all these reasons, the patient will develop the diarrhea, dehydration, weight loss. And we have seen that both of these symptoms, when they are combined together, the patient may die because of the dehydration. So the next last one we have is the CNS or the CVS syndrome. Now the GI is between 7 to 15 gray, and gray, we know that 1 gray is equal to 100 rads. Rad is the radiation absorption dose. So more than 50 or 50, there will be CNS plus CVS symptoms. So there is going to be collapse of the circulatory system. There is going to be necrosis of the cardiac muscle. There will be increase in the permeability, and that will lead to electrolyte imbalance again. So that is the reason that patient die of dehydration. So there will be there is going to be disorientation, incoordination, convulsion, and there is going to be damage to the CNS because there is an increase in the intracranial pressure, and that will lead to the damage to the neuronal tissue, as well as there is going to be damage of the vascular tissue. That is the reason we are telling CNS or CVS syndrome. So this is acute radiation syndrome when the body is exposed to the radiation. So the question that can be asked is, suppose this much of radiation exposure is there, then what will be effect on the organ? Which organ will be affected in this much of dose? Or they can ask the question is that what is the symptom which can be seen? So the treatment is we give the symptomatic relief, because there is no as such treatment. So we can, if secondary infection is there, we can give the antibiotic. We can also replace the fluid or electrolyte replacement, and we can also give the whole blood transfusion, or there can be bone marrow graft also in case of identical twins we can give. So this is about the acute radiation syndrome, and this is about the biological effect of the radiation. I hope that you have enjoyed the video, and this time I'm not leaving you like that. So what you need to do for me and for yourself is, you have to do the question. If you do 10 question also, if you do 5 question also, you have to promise me today. If you want lectures now onwards, you have to promise me that if you do 5 question also, if you do 10 question also, or if you solve the whole chapter from the Dental Pulse or from any other book, you are going to come back again and you are going to comment, so that I know that you guys are reading it and you guys are doing the questions. And that way you will also have the idea, and that way there will be a sense of competition which will develop. Because if one person is commenting, then the other person will see that, okay, he is studying, then I also need to study. So you have to make sure that you have to promise me that for yourself, and for consider it for myself. I'm asking this thing for myself. Consider it that way. You are going to solve the questions. You are not just simply watching the video. You have to solve the question, because I want you to take up a seat. I want you to excel in your NEET exam. So you are going to solve, if you are going to solve 2 question also, if you are going to solve 5 question also, if you are going to solve 10 question or the whole chapter, you are going to comment in the comment section that you have solved the questions. You are going to comment it, and this is a promise which I want from your side. So guys, this is about the biological effect of radiations. I hope that you have enjoyed the video. So if you have enjoyed watching it, give it a thumbs up. Also, you can comment in the comment section below. There is a link in the description box below to support me on Paytm as well as on PayPal to make free videos for you guys and to make free notes. So till then, keep reading, keep learning, stay motivated, and solve questions. Solve questions and come back and comment in the comment section in the description. You will find in the below. So you have to solve the questions and you are going to comment it that you have solved the questions. I'll see you soon next time.